thank you so much for being here today to celebrate the Big Bang Theory. We've been coming to Comic-Con now for 10 years. And that would not be possible without our amazing fans who've been supporting us all along. So thank you to all of you for helping us get here. A few things before we get started. The 11th season of The Big Bang Theory premieres Monday, September 25th at 8 p.m. on CBS. Before we move to our regular time period of Thursdays at 8, 7 central on November 2nd. And of course you can catch it 5 nights a week in syndication and on TBS. And in advance of the season premiere, Warner Home Entertainment will be releasing the complete 10th season on DVD and Blu-ray on September 12th. And you can get it right now on digital as well. Obviously, during today's panel, we want to hear from you, so be sure to use the hashtag WBSDCC so we can follow along with you. And after today's panel, be sure to stop by the Warner Brothers booth, because if you've ever wanted to sit in Sheldon's spot, we have the set set up in our booth where you can do that. So, let's get started. As is tradition here with the Big Bang Theory at Comic-Con, we'd like to start things off with a sizzle reel of some of our favorite moments from last season. So let's roll that reel. Now please welcome our special guest moderators, two very good friends of the Big Bang Theory, who both happen to play characters we absolutely love to hate. Please welcome Ricky Lindholm and John Ross Bowie.
Hello. That's pandering, I'm sorry. Hi, we're gonna have a great morning here. Thank you all so much for coming. We've got writers, we've got cast here. This is gonna be amazing. Are you ready?
Okay, come on, I think you can get more ready than that.
Please say, what? Great, heckling already. Perfect. Just what I wanted. Let's say hi to some writers and executive producers, shall we? Please welcome the guys behind the guys, Dave Getch, Eric Kaplan, and Maria Ferrari. Also rounding out our panel is Steve Holland, Bill Brady, and Steve Villaro. And then some people on camera.
Please welcome to the stage Kevin Sussman. Kunal Nair.
And please say hello to sanctioned Johnny Galecki. Amazing seasons. This is your 10th Comic-Con, is that right?
That's right.
Do you have a favorite Comic-Con memories of beautiful downtown San Diego?
The first year. The first year we were at Comic-Con.
It's been a while.
Johnny and Simon decided to rent a motorboat and take me and Jim and Kaylee and Simon and Johnny on a motorboat in the middle of the water.
Yeah.
We had Chuck was thrilled about that. 10 minutes and managed to commandeer a boat, and I remember Kaylee asking, well, who's going to drive it? And I was like, duh, you are.
Yeah.
It was awesome. We're not excited to hear that we were out on the water. We're
Chuck
not the
was
most nautical cast in the world.
I actually have one. I was our first year here, it was 10 years ago, and it was 1:30 in the morning, and I was going past the hotel bar, and I saw my coworkers, Kaylee Cuoco and Johnny Galecki, and I thought, hey, I'm gonna go hang out with them. I didn't know, A, they were secretly dating, and B, they were right in the middle of a fight. So I walk up, and I can see she's about to cry, and I'm like, I'm gonna go, and they're like, no, it's fine.
No, stay.
Yeah, I certainly didn't want him to go. I was like, you know, you're staying.
So we stand there in silence for like 10 seconds. I'm like, no, really, I'm gonna go, and Kay says, no, stay. Starts crying. So I would like to know, do you remember what you were fighting about, and why would you do that to me?
I think it was a great bonding moment for us, Steve.
You're still talking.
I come to you now for all my relationship problems ever since that day.
It's not a Comic-Con until I make Kaylee cry.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
What a wonderful Comic-Con memory.
Isn't that a lovely memory?
Wait, what were you guys fighting about? I want to know.
I don't know. God.
I don't know.
10 years ago. It's a while ago.
Yeah.
What were you fighting about 10 years ago?
I
hard to remember.
Yeah,
you can't tell me.
Yeah.
It's tough.
I was fighting to get to my room and you wouldn't let me go.
Yeah. No, I forced you to stay, for sure. It was a good memory though, wasn't it?
Okay, I'm gonna go to the next question so you don't have to talk about fighting anymore. Okay, so Sheldon proposed to Amy, as we saw. No thanks to me. What was the mood like on set during that moment?
I remember coming down, I take Polaroids on set. So we must have, what do you think, hundreds of Polaroids at this point that are all up on our little wall of shame in the wardrobe room. So I went up to get my camera for this moment, and I knew we were gonna do it, and I had to get the photograph on my Polaroid, and I came down, and basically everyone and everyone's mother and friend was behind the camera for this one scene, even though we all knew it was gonna happen, but, and I started crying, like yeah. I really, we were all like
crying. We were all crying watching him do it.
I came as close to crying as I'm capable of.
Yes, Kevin almost cried, yes. No, it was really cool. You see so many years and so many relationships, you know, have transformed, and to see that, you know, be this pinnacle of the season, it was just really cool, and we've all just come a long way, and it just made me, we were all kind of crying behind the
so camera. Far, every story has to do with Kaylee crying.
Yes, again. Yes, another crying story.
That one wasn't my fault.
No.
You guys have all worked together for quite some time. Most of these writers have been there for the whole run of the show, but they actually have some questions they wanted, the writers have some questions they wanted me to ask the cast, if that's okay. So Eric Kaplan, wave. Eric Kaplan would like to know, do the actors change in front of each other? That's a yes. You're taking too long.
Oh, I'm sure we have.
No, yeah.
I'm sure we have.
I've seen Simon try to wiggle into his pants much more than I'd like to admit.
Simon wears really tight pants.
And he still fits into them 10 years later.
Same size.
Unbelievable. He's got a great bottom.
So annoying.
Unbelievable, man. Just
after two kids, no less.
Yes.
It is funny though, you know, we rarely miss time on the show. I don't think any of us have ever missed more than 1 or 2 days on the show, but I remember once I had to miss for the day and I came back and Johnny sent me a picture because he took his pants off and sat on my couch.
Yeah.
So that's as close as I got to seeing him naked.
If you guys are interested, I have that picture on my phone. If you see me on the floor, I'll show it to you.
Lucky you. This is a question from Maria Ferrari. Say hello, Maria. The question is, would the actors be friends with the writers in real life? No, you wouldn't. Why are you lying?
Oh.
But would you?
Which one's Maria?
Which one's, who wouldn't you be friends with? Just list that on stage. I'm kidding.
Of course down the line.
Would.
Duh.
No, I'd really be friends with all of you guys.
Yeah. They're hilarious.
Yeah,
right, so
good nice guys. Good people.
Hanging out.
This is actually, I have to say, there's often on shows a bit of a chasm between the stage and the writer's room, and that's certainly not the case on this show. So we're all very, very, very close and share a love for the shared goal that we all have to make the show the best it can be.
Hey, Maria, you have a fun friend story about Kevin Sussman, don't you?
Kevin, I do not know if you remember this, but once I saw you out in the world, we were like going to the Moth, and it seemed like maybe you were on a date, and I was like, oh, it's Kevin from work, I'm gonna go say hi. And you kind of pulled up, and I don't know, I kind of got the vibe that maybe he was like, oh shoot, here's a fan interrupting me on my date.
No.
Did he just sign something for you and walk away?
He just pulled out his headshot.
Kevin carries several signed headshots.
Yeah.
Yeah, 8x10. Yeah. Just because I handed you an 8x10 doesn't mean that I didn't know. No, it's more likely that I just didn't know your name. My awkwardness came off as, you know, I didn't know who you are.
Wait, when were you on a date?
This was a long time ago.
I'm sorry, your rebuttal to the story that you didn't recognize Maria is that you didn't recognize Maria?
Yeah, but no, I recognized her. I don't think I remembered, you know, her name. And and that's not that crazy because it was a long time ago, you know? The crazier thing is all the people that I've been working with for 10 years that I still don't remember.
There is, on stage 25 at Warner Brothers, there on the back wall, there are Polaroids of everybody who works there with their name.
Yes, and I study that like every week.
And why are you sweating right now?
I'm very nervous.
I have the mind of a spaghetti strainer. You know, if I don't see you moments after I look at the chart.
But this, by the way, I recommend this for everybody's job, because you're on the stage and there are people that you've worked with for like 7 or 8 years.
Bill.
And it's hard to go.
Bill.
What?
I know your name. That's where it's headed. I know your name.
We should start lining people up for questions. I imagine there's mics posted out there, right?
Yeah, ask us some questions, guys.
Well,
don't be shy.
We'll throw to you guys in a moment. Well, let's just sort of orderly fashion kind of come up to the mics and line up, and we'll try to get to everybody, but we won't get to everybody.
But in the meantime, we have a question for Kunal. You had one of the sexiest moments of the season in the hot tub with Kevin Sussman. What was that like?
What was it like?
Yeah, what is
it? It was a little disgusting, but not because of Kevin, because Kevin was the best part of the hot tub. The hot tub was slightly dirty, and you have to clean it. And you know, hot tubs should be nice and bubbly and dark. This had lights underneath, so you could see every layer of fat and skin. And we were in there for quite a while shooting, so our skin was like wrinkly and falling off, and the water was, our feet kept touching.
That's how
we got like balance, you know what I mean? And so our legs would touch, and then we'd act like it didn't. So it was quite awkward. It was not sexy.
Like a love scene.
We never discussed this. Had I known, I wouldn't have been so footsie.
I like that one of your biggest complaints is the day you spent at work in a hot tub. Not a lot of people can say that.
Well, tough day.
It was the circumstances.
Yeah, and I don't like putting my head underwater ever. A bunch of people had to coach me, and you know, it's going to be okay. We have a lot of people around in like 2 feet of water. But you know, I do the, you know, when I swim, it's less of a swim, more of a survival stroke. So just having to have my head underwater, and it was horrifying.
It was funny when it got sexy, when we're cheersing each other, like, so tell me, how have you been? Like, that was the kind of fun part, you know? because it felt like just two dudes hanging out in a hot tub. What's the big deal?
Yeah,
at work.
Yeah, let's go to the audience.
Okay. I can't see, but where? Who's the first?
Oh, hi.
Hi.
I miss you.
Oh my gosh!
Wow.
You look incredible.
Why? Thank you.
What is your question?
First of all, my name is the Bud Lady. They know. They've seen me before.
Wait, why did they call
back.
You that?
I'm sorry, what?
Why did they call you that? Never mind, we can talk later. Go ahead.
First of all, thank you for coming back to Comic-Con. We've missed you.
Oh, thank you, guys. Thank you for coming out.
And I work with kids with special needs. Speechless is an amazing show. Thank you so much.
Oh, thank you. You mean Speechless is on Wednesdays at ABC on 8:30?
Yes.
Well, I'm number two on the call sheet, that one.
With Cedric Hardwick, yeah.
Yeah, got it, okay.
Question, because other people want to do, my question is, Penny, have you ever thought of a last name for yourself, since none of us know your maiden name?
I have it in my head what I think that it is.
She's very successful.
But now I'm Penny Hofstetter, so it doesn't matter. She's Penny, she's Cher. She doesn't have a last name. Just one name, Ariel. I need a last name. The mermaid.
Oh, the mermaid.
Yeah, sorry. Go ahead, Spider-Man.
Mr. Parker, fire away.
Good morning. Well, Kunal, since you and I both went to Temple University,
yeah.
What was your journey after graduating to getting your work started in acting and getting on this show?
I played a terrorist on NCIS. And then I booked The Big Bang Theory.
That is amazing.
So my range is incredible.
That's a general rule of thumb. If any aspiring actors are in the audience, usually it's like, usually your second audition is a show that runs for 10 seasons. So bank on that and borrow money from your parents.
Yeah. Hello. What is your question?
Hi, I'm Ken. First of all, I have anniversary, and guys, thank you for bringing John. I tweeted you guys saying, please bring him for a moderator. Kaylee and Johnny, thank you for always saying hi to us on TV.
Cool. Who's next?
My question is for Kaylee. Your reactions are hilarious. So it's the anniversary, season two, you're walking up the stairs talking on the phone, and all of a sudden this big robot crashes out the door. Was that scream genuine? Did he tell you, or was it rehearsed? It looked genuine.
Oh, every reaction on this show is genuine. Trust me. Thank you for saying that. Yeah, I didn't know the robot was coming out. We actually did that for fun. I mean, I knew it was written in, but I didn't know when they were going to send it out.
Kaylee doesn't read the script.
I don't read the script.
Yeah, she knew.
So I just walked up, and there it was. But thank you for that. It's very sweet. Thank you.
You know, speaking of Kaylee's reactions, there's one thing that I've always loved. If you go back and watch the pilot, at the very end, when she's in the car with the guys, Wolowitz starts to sing, and you start to laugh to yourself. I mean, was that a choice, or were you just laughing?
Honestly, no, I was probably just laughing. I don't think it was a choice, because in this entire show, I don't think it's realistic when something funny is going on and you're not laughing. So, and that's what I love about this cat. Like, we laugh at each when they're saying things, like it's completely natural. It's not a written-in thing, but if something's funny to me, it's funny, and you'll see, for sure, me laughing all the time on the show. Like, I'm constantly entertained by these friends and these people that are around me, but they are completely real.
But what I love about that moment is, you know, the show follows a journey of these guys and Penny becoming friends, and it's such an honest moment where she just met them, and she's in a car with them, and she's actually starting to love them. It's like the first seed of it. If you ever catch
That's
the pilot again,
sweet.
You should check it out. It's a great moment.
I remember from the very beginning when we would be in editing, and there was always, if you were looking for something to do, if there was a moment, and you could always, our editor, Peter Chekos, you could say, I bet Kaylee's doing something. Because you always have...
That is so sweet.
But as Steve is saying, because your role, especially in the early seasons, was outsider to this group, and how Penny was processing what was happening was always a very key part of the story. But, you know, in that you know, and that great thing of acting between moments, you're always a remarkable
really
person
really
to go
sweet.
To in a cut.
Thank you. Well, it was never laughing at them. It's literally genuine. They're hilarious. And, you know, as are your friends and people that are around you that you find entertaining. So, constantly
thank
making
you.
Me laugh.
Thank you. Thank you.
Looking at me.
Kitty cat.
Oh, yeah. I'm gonna cue.
There's a cat over there.
I'm gonna cue Kaylee up real quick. Hang on.
Look at her.
Yeah. Ask the question.
Come on.
Hey guys, my name's Dominique. Just want to let you guys know you've changed my life. It feels good to be a nerd. So, my question is, what do you guys like to geek out to? What is your go-to?
Everyone is.
Ask this question for some reason.
Yeah, everyone has something.
Board games for me.
Board games. I'm Star Wars. My dog is called Boba Fett. Pretty cool. We're gonna get another one and name him or her Django. We'll have the Fets in the house. That'll be cool. What else?
You like guitars? I don't know. I think it's anything you're obsessed with, right?
Yeah. You can kind of just be passionate about something,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So. Johnny, the first year you were very excited about the G.I. Joes.
About the G.I. Joes.
You remember the first year we were here 10 years ago?
I don't remember that.
You don't remember?
Yeah, I was 8 in the
That's actually, the G.I. Joes were what Kaylee and Johnny were fighting about.
Yeah. Yeah. Bill, can you tell the story of walking on the floor the first year that Johnny and Kaylee were here?
So it's the very first, 10 years ago, it's the very first Comic-Con. We had done the panel, and that was a time when it was possible for this cast to walk out on the floor of Comic-Con safely. And Chuck Lorre and I and Johnny and Kaylee started to walk, we wanted to see Comic-Con, and we started to walk on the floor, and we're seeing all of these cool things, and there's the Bat Cycle from the TV show, and there's all this other stuff, and Kaylee said, where are we going? And we said, to here, to this.
We're in it.
And she stopped and said, I'm going back to the hotel.
No offense, I just felt very lost. Very wild out there. Very wild.
It was a very Penny moment.
It, for me. Yeah, exactly. It was honest. It was like I'm confused.
As we're talking about the mood on set, this is a question that I'm taking away from somebody. I apologize, but are there ever? I've seen some pranks on set, and I've seen some sort of surprises you planned for the writers. Do you have any particular stories about pranks or surprises that have maybe not gone as planned, or has gone so well?
You know, our gag reels are very, very funny. We rarely do any sort of planned out stuff, but there was actually one experience. It was, I don't know if you guys have seen this episode, one of the Valentine's Day episodes.
I think it was season 6.
Season 6? Okay, it was me and you and Simon and Melissa, it was the four of us in a scene, and the scene was in us fighting. So we were fighting in the scene, and we thought it would be really funny for the gag reel. We didn't tell anyone.
Take it too far.
To take it one step too far, that Johnny would fake punch me and I'd fall out of frame. So like if I'm sitting here, I'd just fall out of frame, and then on camera you would see me go out. We're in this big fight, because in the scene we're fighting. So I'm like, okay, Johnny, so you're gonna fake punch me, I'm gonna fall out of frame and do this whole thing. So we set this whole thing up.
Then I called hair and makeup and I said, bring me some hair extensions.
Yeah, bring hair extensions, he could throw them.
Like tearing her hair.
I wanted to make like a funny scene. So we did it, and I fell over, and the chair, no one knew this, and I didn't either, clocked me in the head, and I just thought, oh, I gotta, like, calm down, it's a little bruise, but I'm still acting, like, I'm under there, and he's still, like, fake punching me, and, like, throwing the hair, and I come back up, I'm like, how did it look? And all I see is Simon's face, and it was my blood just gushing out of the top, right, and you know, like, when you watch, like, boxing, that area, for some reason, is, like, so it was shooting, and I'm like, so how did it look? And Simon's staring at me. Simon is like, I see his face. He's like, you get, and it's like everywhere. And then I'm like, oh my, and it was all over me. And I had to go get stitches that day. That we were shooting in the evening, get stitches that day, and then come shoot the next day. And we had to change the blocking. If you watch the episode, I'm faced a certain way because I had stitches in my forehead. And then I got back and there were all these signs, like, no more fun allowed on the set of the day. But I think we found a clip.
We went through 1,000 tapes and we found the clip of Kaylee. It's blood free, but
you have to listen.
You can put the blood in your head.
Yeah.
Can we
show it?
Yeah.
Simon's face is like this.
we're not allowed to do those jokes anymore.
Just realize how horribly, I'm horribly
I like
listening to you.
Just calm down, sorry. Everyone. Get me
calm down, everyone.
Yeah, I didn't hear
about it. It was horrifying.
I like it as everyone's running in to protect you. Johnny's still wrapping up.
I know! I
beat you in.
And if you listen carefully, you can hear Kaylee say from the floor, it all went awry.
I'm starved for life. You probably are too. Do we do we have another question down here? I bet we do. Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
Hey.
I'm Pam. Absolutely love you guys, by the way. My question is there anything that you want to happen to your characters next season? Like specifically?
Oh my gosh.
It's so hard. You don't really think that way when things are going well. You know, we have the utmost trust in the writers. Who am I to? Why would I try to think up anything when I know that
you know, we get the script.
They're going to come up with gold, you know?
We get the script the day before we start the next episode. So we have no idea what's going on. It's almost like every Tuesday night when we get the new script, start on Wednesday, is like Christmas. Because you open up the packet, you get to read, and we're all so excited to read the next episode for us. So we trust the writers implicitly, and... So yeah, what's gonna happen, guys?
Well, we know that if Kuther Pali ever becomes a terrorist, you can handle it.
Just put on a mustache, you'll be good.
But it, no, really is a question for the writers. Maria, what do you see happening to your character next season?
When they asked the writers to send in questions for the panel, that was like the one that all the writers said, was like, do they have any story ideas?
They'd be specific. I know you didn't ask me, but the window's kind of closing for Barry and Amy to go out on a date. Yeah, and I'm just floating that balloon right here publicly in front of all of you as witnesses that me and Dr. Bialik make an adorable couple. Let's do another question from the audience.
Alondra, I just first have to say I love Kaylee and Kunal. This is like amazing right now.
Aww. Thank you so much. Sorry, Johnny.
I like
thanks
you.
For bringing that up. Yeah, love you too,
Ricky. You and I'll hang out later.
Yeah. My question is, which has been your favorite episode of the entire season?
Yeah, it's so hard. I'm so now I'm glad I wasn't a part of that. That's a difficult question.
I still like the I almost said Easter egg hunt. It was not an Easter egg hunt. The big
scavenger hunt.
Yes, that was so fun because we all were, a lot of us were part of it. It just was really funny. I like when we're all doing things together and it's very physical. It just always makes me laugh. And I got to Melissa pushed me over. It was just, she's wickedly strong. It was fun. I like when we have this big group episodes.
I liked it when the three guys got high in the desert.
Yeah, that was funny.
That was really funny. I got to make fun of Simon's accent, or Johnny's accent, for the American accent, I got to make fun of it for once, which was really fun.
And what does that sound like?
Yeah.
What? Do it? everything you say sounds so stupid. An American. Stars are pretty, aren't they? That was funny when, it's funny when he's like, Raj, the world is spinning too fast. Make it stop. And I'm like, so funny. And that whole like monologue about rabbits, about being the king of rabbits.
And I want to hear more of your American accent.
What?
I want to hear more of your American accent.
You want to hear more of my American accent? I wish Simon was here, because then he'd just make fun of me in my Indian accent.
Yeah.
But.
Okay, this is a question from Bill Prady for the cast. Actually for the writers too. What famous guest star generated a fanboy fangirl moment?
What? Bob Newhart for me, certainly.
What famous guest star made you?
I have an answer.
If I know Kevin, he has several.
I'll try to keep it brief. When I first came on the show, one of the earlier seasons, I met Will Wheaton, who I had been a fan of. And I was, you know, I try not to get starstruck and stuff, and I tried to play it off all cool.
And he immediately, he's so nice, he made me feel super comfortable. Like, within minutes of meeting him, he was teaching me a card game, Queen's Necklace. And it was great. And I was like, oh yeah, okay, he's just a person. We're all just people. And then, years later, when Adam West was on set, Will Wheaton, the whole time he was talking about how amazing it is, because he's a huge Adam West fan, and he was talking about how awesome it is to be in the same room, and it wasn't until like late in the week that I happened to be standing there when he sort of walked over to Adam West, all super nervous, and he did the thing that I did to him, to Adam West. You know, Mr. West, I didn't want to bother you, but I just...
Oh, Will, Mr. Wheaton, the first time you met him? Mr. Wheaton.
Wait, you don't...
Card game.
Wait, I'm the only one he makes call Mr. Wheaton?
Do you guys remember the show The Wonder Years? I remember when I first met, because I got to make out with Danica McKellar on the show.
Oh, yeah!
And I remember my when I was growing up in New Delhi, I had my first kiss in eighth grade, and I didn't know what I was doing. And I closed my eyes and I remembered the first time that Winnie and Kevin kissed on the park bench. I said, just pretend like you're doing that. And then in real life, I mean in life on Big Bang Theory life, I actually got to kiss Winnie, I mean Danica McKellar in real life. And that was a story that came full circle. 9 months later, she was pregnant. That is a fact. Not Penny, but that's just a fact.
Who was your fangirl, fanboy moments from the writers?
Adam West was a remarkable thing because, and I made him call me Old Chum. But there was a day that I had spoken to Will Wheaton in the morning, and then it was the same day we were talking to Leonard Nimoy about coming and doing the voice, and he called on the phone, and I talked to him on the phone, and then I talked later in the day to LeVar Burton, who was calling to try to get a clip or something of the show he'd done, and I said, LeVar, if I could go back in time and tell my younger self that there's a day in my life when I talked to Wesley Crusher and Mr. Spock and Geordi LaForge, I would have died and never made it. Said time paradox, and then
that's amazing.
I have a really good Adam West story. So he was on our 200th episode, and after our table read, he called me over. He had some questions about the script, and he had a line in the script where he told, Leonard and Kuther Polly, don't ring my doorbell or my poodles will go crazy. And Adam said to me, do you think I could have a tougher dog, like a Rottweiler? And I said, well, Mr. West, I mean, you could, but I don't think it's as funny. And he said, well, I have poodles in real life, so I guess it's fine.
What about you guys? What was your favorite?
I guess for me, we've had lots of great ones, but meeting James Earl Jones and having him on set for the week was amazing, and getting to hear words we wrote delivered in that voice when he gets to say, I like Star Wars too, was fantastic. And Carrie Fisher was in that episode as well.
Yeah.
And which, this was surprising, but they met for the first time on our set. They had never met before. He came out and she said, Dad, and they hugged, and that was the first time. Wow.
I think I have to say Stan Lee, because he was so cool and such a stud. He really was. Like, oh my god, he got so much swagger. Stephen Hawking? Oh my god.
Stephen Hawking came, you know, we shot the Stephen Hawking scene in his office with Jim, so the rest of the actors weren't there, but Stephen Hawking came and watched a run-through of our show.
Yep.
And watching Simon do the Stephen Hawking voice while Stephen Hawking is watching the run-through was pretty incredible. Yeah. He loved it.
Do you remember Kaylee had the line in the episode?
Yes, I'll never forget.
Somebody says, do you know who Stephen Hawking is? Do you remember your line back?
The guy in the wheelchair?
It's the wheelchair dude who invented time.
Who invented time. And we're doing the run-through, and Mr. Hawking is literally right here, just in my eye line as I'm saying this joke. And I said it, and I just looked at him, I'm like, I'm so sorry. And he was laughing, he loved it. He loved being there. He was just amazing. Yeah, awesome. We've had some amazing people on the show.
Christopher Lloyd.
Christopher Lloyd!
Oh, he was incredible.
I don't think I ever laughed so hard than that scene.
No one could keep it straight face.
Oh my God. Because we didn't know what he was going to do. He always said something different.
Bob Newhart was a remarkable, especially for those of us who grew up watching Newhart and to come on the show. And then there was a point where somebody was giving, the director was giving Bob a note, and he said, well, maybe you could do that Newhart stutter here on this line. And Bob Newhart said, I don't stutter, I stammer. Do you know the difference? And our director said no. And Bob Newhart said, a house in Bel Air.
I think also Billy Bob Thornton was a pretty cool
one. Oh, he was
too.
So cool. Billy Bob Thornton.
God, I can't believe some of these people.
Yeah.
You think about it. It's amazing.
Let's throw to this young lady here.
Aww.
Hi guys, I just wanted to say thank you for all the work you do, like, for that show. I'm so grateful. And my question is, if time travel was a thing, like real, to what part of the show would you go back? To change it or just to see it again, to relieve the scene?
If we could go forward, all the scripts would have been written.
But if we go backwards, we'll know what all the episodes need to be for the next year. So that's
you know the show's recorded, so you could watch it now. You don't need to waste your time travel trip to watch old episodes of The Big Bang Theory. Current technology could let you do that, and you could, like, you know, kill Hitler or something. But I don't know.
I have an actual answer. It was the first time. Enough of that foolishness. The first time that Penny said I love you to Leonard, one of my all-time favorite moments.
That was so cute. Aww. The one time you didn't make me cry. You did make me cry. I did cry, actually. A lot of crying.
I think we both did that time.
Yeah, yeah.
Kaylee, you gotta pull it together.
I know! I'm falling apart.
Bradley.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hi!
Hi!
I'm such a huge fan. And this is actually my first San Diego Comic-Con. I came all the way from New Jersey. Yeah, New Jersey. I'm sorry.
Oh,
yeah. Woo! Oh, okay. We have the best pizza.
I'm from Staten Island, so.
Fight.
My question is, I know you guys have been playing the same characters for about 10 years, and I just wanted to know which character would you like to switch to besides, in the future?
That's a great question.
Yeah. I'd like to switch with Cinnamon. The dog.
Like to switch with Cinnamon.
Cinnamon is spoiled.
Yep. Oh, nice. You always get the cutest outfits. I mean, let's be honest. That'd be fun, I'm just saying. It'd be nice to not wear four layers under the
I
summer.
Wish I had four layers, I'm always freezing.
Yeah, but I mean, it'd be nice to wear some shorts and a tank top for once on the show, you know?
The wardrobe room has this incredibly depressing shelf that is just like 25 sweater vests.
Yeah, yeah.
All stacked up in a row with Raj on top of it. Breaks my heart, no matter what the weather is.
Brown, yeah.
Who else would I want to trade with another actor?
I wouldn't mind taking a shot at Wallowitz. I mean, you know, tired of being the third wheel. I want to be the man in the house.
It's hard to say because that kind of suggests that you think you could do a better job than them. Which was, you know, certainly. But I always thought Kevin would make a great Leonard.
Kevin would make a good Leonard?
Yeah.
Well, you don't need one person.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks, Mom.
When we're
meeting you at the car at 5.
Johnny, do you remember when we were in the very first conversations about this, that Chuck approached you about Sheldon, and you said, no, that you preferred Leonard.
Right.
Yeah.
But I hadn't met Kevin at the time. I may have pitched Kevin for that. Yes, that is true. I wanted to be part of the Leonard Penny love story, even before Kaylee was cast.
Oh.
And then only tenfold after.
This is a question for the writers. Do any of the stories in the show come from your real lives?
You?
Don't be embarrassed. Just be honest.
A lot of the writers' room is us telling stories from our lives and crying over it, and then trying to make it funny.
I did put my baby to sleep by sleeping with him in the crib for like 2 years.
Aww.
Don't do that. It's bad.
You know that. Sorry. Go ahead.
No, I was gonna say in the first. I mean, in a writers' room, especially a comedy writers' room, you just basically tell painful stories from your life, and then people laugh at them, and then then they laugh at you and make a script. But in the very first season, there's Penny is drunk and has had a fight with her boyfriend and goes in and says to Leonard that she'll spend the night with him, and Leonard doesn't want it to happen under those circumstances. And that was a story that I told from my life, and I was mocked by Chuck so mercilessly in the room. And he said, well, the only way we're gonna put that in the show is if Penny mocks him for this, because no man would ever do that under any circumstance.
But even specific jokes, I remember we were trying to think of things when Raj was getting cut off and when they were discovering what he'd spent his money on. So we were trying to think of foolish things Raj could have spent his money on. And I think I pitched that he had adopted a penguin at the zoo. And people were like, well, it has to be something people would actually do. Like, that's too silly. And I'm like, no, that's a thing. My son adopted a penguin. Penguins, and he had adopted a penguin.
That's hilarious.
And you know that Stephen Hawking, remote control Stephen Hawking, I thought that would be a fun thing for us to put on the show. So I told Chuck, and he's like, that's offensive. You can't do that. I'm like, I think he's going to be okay with it. So it was when, in that episode, everyone is telling Wallace, that's a bad idea. You can't do that. And so it was really my argument with Chuck, whether or not it could be on the show, was what we ended up having happen about it in the episode.
As I recall, we knew it was offensive when Kripke thought it was a good idea. Which is a fine litmus test in general.
Yeah.
Sometimes you'll be hanging out with the writers at a bar having a drink, and Simon and I will be having a drink after the show with some of the writers. We'll all be hanging out. And in the next episode, I'm like...
We talked about
Simon
that.
And I were doing this, having the same conversation in the bar the night we were the writers.
The dating, when we were doing the dating. The online dating. I was doing the online dating.
Yeah, I mean, Simon Wolowitz making fun of Roger's accent came from us hanging
Absolutely.
Out, right?
And you doing your American accent, and then Simon doing you doing the American accent. That was all from the bar.
And then we have time for one more audience question, and it'll go to this lady here.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gabriella, and I'm from the Dominican Republic. First ever San Diego Comic-Con, and my friends and family back home all love your show. We've been following it for a good 8-9 years at this point. And with all of the amazing episodes that we've seen, my question for all of you is, what is the most memorable scene or episode that you have recorded? And if you've had a chance to redo it, how would you do it?
Well, that's the third part, is it? Huh. Mm-hmm. How would you... I mean, to be honest, every time I watch any scene that I'm in, I'm like, I'm so fat. I don't know what's wrong with me. Why did I make that choice? I'm such a shitty actor. Like, so that's okay. It's okay. We're artists. It happens, right?
Yeah.
That's the way we are. So yeah, I don't know. I'd probably reshoot a lot of the things that I've done, right?
For me, it's like looking back into this archive of hairstyles. I'm just like, oh my God, like what? But I mean, so many. It's 10 years of hair. Hair changes, but there was a lot of hair, a lot of hairstyles, still a lot of hairstyles.
If I had to go back, I probably wouldn't touch Kunal's feet as much as I did.
I'd love if they kept my hair curly on the show so I don't have to flat iron it for 20 minutes.
Flat irons it, yeah.
Flat iron, north comes straight.
Simon too.
Simon too.
Simon's got a wonderful mane of hair that he just, they just kind of dome with about 20 pounds of product. If he was here, I'd run my fingers through it. It's incredible.
Yeah.
We have a very special treat for this, the end of our panel. Steve, why don't you you set us up for this rather participatory moment we're going to have.
Sure. So sometimes we write and shoot things that we love, but they don't make it on TV. So one thing from this season that you never got to hear was Amy singing an alternate version of Soft Kitty to Sheldon. So I thought we could end things here maybe with a sing-along if you guys would help us out. We're gonna put the words on the screen for the never-before-seen version of Soft Kitty about other animals. So it starts with Soft Kitty, and then there's two more animals after that, if you'll help us out. Maybe would the cast start us off?
Yeah, of course. Let's do it in E minor. Okay,
Kitty, warm kitty, little ball of fur.
Sing along.
Happy kitty, sleepy kitty, purr.
Now get ready.
All right, soft bunny.
Soft bunny, warm bunny, floppy ears. Happy bunny, sleepy bunny, hop, hop, hop.
If you really put your hearts into heart turn.
One more time, let's do the turtle one more time, but everyone sing at the top of your lungs.
Heart turtle!
Here we go, 1, 2, 3, go!
Heart turtle!
Real quick story about the first Comic-Con we came to. We were on a train from Los Angeles, and I was sitting next to Chuck Lorre, and I said, how big is the auditorium that we're in? And it was this room. And I said, that's a lot of seats to fill. He said, yeah, it kind of is, and we're a new show. And I said, you realize we're not a sci-fi show either, right? And we looked at the schedule, and I think at the same time, Battlestar Galactica, I think, was happening.
Yeah.
And I was like, we might want to look into a smaller room, man. And he was like, gave him this complex. So he got on the phone and trying to get a 200 seat room or something at the last minute, and everything was booked. And when we got here, we couldn't believe that the seats were filled and that they had to turn down a few hundred people after. Your support and love has been staggering
day
and
one.
Shocking. And we love you. We really love you. From the bottom of our hearts, thank you so very much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.